Inviting me.
Eldad, the microphone.
Let me know. Okay. I usually don't read papers, but I decided to try today. But I will probably not succeed, so we'll see how it works. Okay. Okay. So I read it and I try to read it nice. I used to work in the radio for 10 years. Thank you, Soli and Mayor, for inviting me to speak to the distinguished forum. This paper will examine the twists and turns of Iranian-Israeli relations through the perspective of two cities. Jerusalem, Israel's holiest city and eternal capital, and Persepolis, the Persian capital of the world's first real empire. Before I continue, I don't want you to think that this kind of methodology is maybe a little bit unusual here in the center. Typically, we focus on interest, economics, the hard things. But after studying Iran for many years and participating in Sufi movement for also many years, I reached the conclusion that there is nothing like interest. We only have desires, and the desires come from our inside, and they come from our inside because of the way we grew, and because of our culture, and because of all the texts we read, and in the end of the day, there are no hard interests. It's all we speak about, or Anderson speak about imagination, but we are imagined people, we are imagined sense, we are imagined self, we are all a composition of chemistry, and in the end of the day, without being overly mystical, we should remember this. And thing is that all of these actors, the Shah, Khomeini, Ben-Gurion, they believed in that. So this is what made them tick. So I ask you to bear with me and accept a little bit of a different attitude. That and my purpose is not to prove something, but to make people think and at least enjoy it. Okay. So we're speaking about Persepolis. It was the Iranian Emperor Cyrus the Great, often seen as a messianic figure in Judaism, who chose the site of Persepolis, opened the gates of Jerusalem before returning refugees from Babylon, and allowed the construction of the Jewish temple. Iranian Jews used to travel to Jerusalem for the Hajj, but Iran, the country, never recognized Jerusalem as Israel's capital and kept its delegation in Ramat Gan, even when many embassies dotted Jerusalem. With all this, his apparent reverence for Cyrus, Iran's former Shah Mohammad Reza Pahlavi was reluctant to embrace Jerusalem and consequently lost Persepolis as well. For Jalal al-Ahmad, Jerusalem was the center of the world's most promising polity, Israel, the eastern capital of a holy guardianship, or Vilayat in Persian. Jerusalem's leaders were God's, for Jalal al-Ahmad, were God's closest friends, he argued. Khomeini, too, believed in God as a friend who told him to create his own guardianship, Vilayat, and not to destroy Persepolis, as recommended by the hangman and future reformist Ayatollah Khalkhali, and to keep the Gulf Persian, not Islamic, not Arab. Since that moment, it became clear that one day an Iranian embassy would be opened in Jerusalem. That's my prediction. Indeed, Khomeini wanted to go to Jerusalem by way of first conquering Karbala and Baghdad, where Iran is still stuck. As for Jerusalem, which is also holy to Christianity and only Sunni Islam, not Shia Islam, the Islamic Republic adopted the city as a totem, replacing its assassinated royalty. I will explain this a little later. Jerusalem became a battle cry for the revolutionary spirit, no less than death to Israel. Thus, Chodesh, Kodesh in the Hebrew, became a special day in the Iranian calendar. The Chodesh Jerusalem force is responsible for extraterritorial operations, mainly in the Arab lands. Unlike most of the Jews, Iranians always remained in Iran, but the Jews were better in preserving the one capital and one religion at the center of their identity. Thanks to the revolution, Iranians too are now scattered all over the world. Welcome, Professor Uri Bialer.
Please join us. Yes.
Great.
Yes, great. From the second.
Okay, I will just finish the introduction. An Iranian embassy in Jerusalem will signal a return of Iran to itself and of Iranians to themselves. And I'm using here Shariati's expression, but okay, so I'm following here in the footsteps of Professor Shabar, and I would like to start with Mayor Ezri, and I basically have the same quotation that was given by David Ben-Gurion to Mayor Ezri. I didn't check the quotation, but what he said was basically, dear Mayor, please take care of Iranian interest before Israeli or any other interest. Consider Iran as your first priority. So why did Ben-Gurion say something like that? Why did he give such a directive? He was, after all, the Prime Minister of Israel, not the Prime Minister of Iran. So he had, in my view, pragmatic and ideological consideration. On the pragmatical level, the answer was that Iran was simply important, and I know that Ben-Gurion also gave similar instructions to the ambassador to the United States. So of course, as we heard from Soli, if Iran was to be successful and strong, it was good for Israel. So very simple. But there was also an ideological level, and he wrote a lot extensively about that. Ben-Gurion believed in world redemption. He believed that Israel was not just appearing. It had some mystical or spiritual role. And he actually followed the two main strategies of the Jewish people. One of them is the principle that it's moral and also pragmatic, Kol Yisrael Arevim Zeh B'Zeh, which means all of Israel must have solidarity with each other, but no less important is Tikkun Olam, the betterment of the world. Ben-Gurion argued that Israel that symbolized the active role of the Jews, what in Iran they call today international Zionism, which means organized Jews working, lobbying, doing politics, all of this, international Zionism. This is Kol Yisrael. It's something that Muslims expect from the Ummah. It's something the Jews expect from the people. But Ben-Gurion also was a great student of mysticism. I don't know how many of you know that he was a pioneer of the New Age in Israel. He went to Tibet for Vipassana. He was a student of Feldenkrais. And also, he was a student of the great Kabbalist Baal HaSulam, Rabbi Ashlag. He's the teacher of Madonna. And he was an ex-communist, he was a communist turned mystic, just like Shariati. And they were studying seriously, and I'm sure that he learned about the concept of abundance coming out when giving things. Things are moving and shaking, and so this was his policy. It was extremely pragmatic, but also we lived in all kinds of mysticism. So when we speak about mysticism in Iran, we should also look at mysticism here. There is another argument that I found in Ben-Gurion's books that are extremely relevant to Iran, and I pose a question here. He argued that the only way to break Arab enmity to Israel was not just like Jabotinsky to have the Iron Wall, a very powerful country that would force the other side to recognize us. He believed that the Arabs would never recognize Israel, no matter how weak they were. But the only way was to give the same manner to countries in the third world, particularly Iran, but also any other countries of the third world, and bringing blessing, baha, to all these countries, and in the hope that these countries, through their relations with the Arabs, would bring, they would move the Arabs to change their position and reconcile with Israel. Okay, so let's go a little more into the mystical realm. You'll see that it will help us to understand things. I'm going back to the father of Zionism, Herzl. Herzl was also working on the theological level. And this is something that I really want everybody here to understand this, and everybody in Tehran to understand this. Israel was working, it was based on theological considerations. The first thing Herzl did was to meet with the Pope in the Vatican and with the Caliph of the Muslims, Sultan Abdul Hamid, the second in Istanbul. He asked both people to establish a Jewish state that will be compatible with Islamic Sharia and with Catholicism. His idea was to create a guardianship. He argued that the Zionist movement should be a guardian of Jewish people, and he based it on the Roman law. The Roman law, as you know, the Vatican is the continuation of the Respublica Romanorum, and the Roman law is relevant to the Vatican. And as for Islam, he didn't want an independent state. He wanted a Jewish national home in the within the contours of the Islamic Caliphate, and paying taxes and renting it, the land from the Muslims. Unfortunately, both religious political leaders rejected this offer. But today, we know that the Vatican has changed the theology. One of the main reasons, according to experts of Catholic theology, was the establishment of Israel. The establishment of Israel undermined the Catholic dogma. And I believe that also Islamic Sharia will change as a result of the existence of Israel. And we can see already that the Sharia is changing. The Islamic Republic is one example. People, they don't pay the jizya anymore. You have Jewish and Christian members of parliament. So the Sharia is also changing, the dogma is changing, and therefore there is a lot of room for us. Okay, so let's go back. I have enough time, or yes. Okay, let's go back to Jalal al-Ahmad. He visited Israel in 1962. I believe that Jalal al-Ahmad was the main inspiration for Khomeini, and actually the Islamic Republic is predicated to a large extent on the Israeli model. It is very important. Jalal al-Ahmad considered Israel to be a velayat. Velayat in the three senses. First of all, velayat is a country or a province. Second of all, velayat is a guardianship. He, without knowing all what I told you about Herzl, he saw Israel as a guardian of the entire Jewish nation, just like Iran. As you know, Khamenei, one of his titles is Vali Amre Muslimin Jahan. So Iran, he has guardianship over the entire Muslim Ummah and actually over entire humanity. Very similar to the idea of Israel having guardianship over the Jewish people. And finally, he said that Velayat is the sense of Vali Olah, the friend of God, that Israel is led, if not, his words are, if not by prophets, then by Oliya. Oliya are the friends of God, the people who are directly connected. This concept, I believe, is the basis of the religious theology of the Islamic Republic of Iran. It is true that people speak about the al-Faqih, or the guardianship of jurisprudence. This is what Khomeini wrote. But Khomeini also, when he was in Paris, spoke about democracy. He didn't mean either. Of course, Sharia is good to keep people in check, but he really believes that what Iran is following the Platonic, the Plato's model of the philosopher king, and the mystical derivations of this, and developed by Muslims and philosophers and mystics, which means that a highly educated, trained person could reach the level of an imam and could get a direct channeling from God, from the angels. And that's why it's a velayat of faqih and not of fuqaha, because it's one person that is channeling, and it's not important what really the Sharia says, because there is always new information coming from this channeling. I'm involved in research of Iranian educational system, and this is all over the curriculum. They teach mysticism and Sufism from grade one. And I just want to quote from a book of philosophy. Of course, Khomeini speak about himself there in many cases. Whenever a sage, a wise person, has become immersed in theosophy, and has become a master in the field, he has full authority and is the caliph, a deputy of God. Caliph here is given out the expression khalifa, because the owner of the status of caliphate must receive matters and truth directly from the source of glory. A source of glory can be the imam, can be God himself, can be angels, and so on. So we see now that Iran is led by mystics, but the Shah also considers himself to be a mystic. And so basically, most of us have some weird aspects in their personality. But the Shah really, he talked with Ali. And I would say that his attitude towards Israel was mainly pragmatic. He was not that excited about the religiosity and what Al-Ahmad said and so on. I think his attitude was pragmatic, as we see. This was different when it comes to Sadat, who was also trained mystic. I would say that that we have here Uri Bialer, and I read his article and I believe it for him. The relations began with helping Israel to bring Jews to Israel, just like Cyrus. And then there were a series during the 1950s and 60s, Israel helped in many, many ways. Some observers argue that the 1967 Six-Day War served as a turning point, leading to less warmth in the relations because of the demise of the pan-Arab threat. Of course, we have the periphery strategy of Israel working in Soviet threat, working against pan-Arabism, radical pan-Arabism. Yeah. Okay, 3 minutes. Okay, so we jump this. Let's see what... I want to say one thing. First of all, the Shah was not a puppet. He was a very strong leader. It is very important to know that, particularly in the 1970s, he was controlling the United States, not the other way around, because he had major lobbies, army industry, oil industry, banking, and so on. Another point that I want to make is the great closeness between Anwar Sadat and the Shah. They became extremely close in spirit. Both represented ancient empires, and both believing that they have mystical powers. Sadat would go for weeks on Vipassana to meet Abu Khom, and since day one, I believe there was a really close emotional relation between the two throughout the 1970s. You know, I read some people say, you know, the relations between Israel was not that strong. You know, the whole kind of facts, but in reality, Israel and Iran collaborated very powerfully. But what is most important is that Iran and Egypt with its melodic concept of harmony, and Iran with its concept of tolerance and multiculturalism, they tried to bring peace and harmony among the countries of the Middle East. And you will see it in Zofar. I read a lot for this about the war in Zofar, in Muscat. Very interesting.
Yemen.
Not in Yemen. The insurgents came from Yemen. He helped Saddam Hussein to stabilize his regime in 1975. He allowed the British to leave the Gulf. There was the Nixon doctrine. So basically, and he was pressuring Israel to respond to Sadat and welcome into Jerusalem and all of this. So the theory of Ben Gurion would have it that the Shah would convince Sadat to work with Israel. I don't have any facts to support that, but what I know is that they really were buddies and they worked for peace. And indeed, the fact that the Shah pressured Saddam Hussein, pressured Israel, pressured here, pressured there, does not mean that it didn't work for Israel. Because in the long run, particularly in Egypt, it helped us build the bilateral relations. And in the short run with Iran, the bilateral relations remained powerful. And he had, together with Sadat, the regional view, maybe with a little help of the Americans. That's it? Okay, so I will just...
Another minute.
Read the last paragraph. Okay, 10 minutes for taking the... Okay. In conclusion, the Shah of Iran never recognized Jerusalem as the capital of Israel and never opened an embassy there. He tried to follow in the footsteps of Cyrus the Great, but the most famous act of that great Persian king eluded him. He also did not listen carefully to his people and thus lost his kingdom. The Islamic Republic will never find peace until it reconciles all aspects of Iranian heritage, and this includes all forms of Islam, other religions, and non-religions. It will have to come to terms with ancient Persian heritage alongside various cultures and collective rights of the country, of that country that is extremely diversified country. But the road to Persepolis, and what I mean by Persepolis here, it's a metaphor, an Iranian reconciliation of its various identities and needs. The road to Persepolis, to this internal harmony, goes through Jerusalem, only by recognizing that the Jews, for centuries partially oppressed by Shiism in Iran, have a right to their capital, a right recognized but no one else by Cyrus the Great, that Iran will have eternal peace. Thank you.